Hello and welcome to Pradoe Hall. This is Evacuation to the Manor House.
On today's show, our modern-day evacuees discover that a servant's life stinks.
You're doing poo.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm doing nothing.
Their new tough regime is hard to stomach.
And swallow.
To be honest, I actually threw up in my mouth and swallowed it again.
And their first posh dinner...
I'm going to be on my best behaviour to see the lady.
Have it where you've got my table manners.
...is a disaster.
The actual dining etiquette was atrocious. It's like pigs at the trough.
First century children. They're fashion obsessed.
I like my clothes to be like leopard prints and like really bright and electric colours.
Gadget mad.
I love Transformers.
And used to having things their own way.
I hate being bossed around. I like being the one to boss people around.
But all that's about to change.
We shall fight on the beaches.
Yeah, I'll take good care of them.
I'm going to be an eyesore.
Not my cup of tea, I'd say.
I think they look ridiculous.
Yesterday, our 12 boys and girls were transported back to the 1940s, where they'll be reliving the experience of nearly 2 million wartime children who were evacuated from the cities to escape German bombing. A lucky few were sent to the grandest houses in all the land.
You rang, my ladyship?
Our modern-day evacuees are guests of Lord and Lady Alstead.
But they're not going to be living a life of luxury. Oh, no. Our evacuees are living below stairs in the servants' quarters. And so far, it's all been taken a bit of getting used to.
Come on, make it snappy. We haven't got all day. Come on.
As soon as they arrived, the butler set about whipping them into shape.
Mr. Henderson. It's really evil.
And introducing them to the delights of household chores.
Who's washed these? They're not clean.
They don't like being bossed around.
Do all these again.
I think it'll be a living nightmare.
They soon discovered if they want to enjoy the privileges...
Good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon, sir.
...and cakes of the upper classes, they're going to have to learn some airs and graces.
What are you doing? You're not putting... You're not using your fingers to edge cabbage with, are you?
After an exhausting first day, the children couldn't wait to get to bed, even if the ensuite bathroom was a bit close for comfort.
If anyone goes number two at night and I'm next to it, you're gonna get the consequence in the morning.
All in all, a bumpy start to manor house life during the Second World War.
Right, come along. Everybody into bed, please.
It's early morning, and our boys and girls are about to get a short, sharp 1940s wake-up call.
Come on, wakey-wakey, boys and girls.
There's no time for snoozing. Housekeeper Mrs. Dobson knows only too well that Pradoe Hall won't run itself.
Now, I want you washed, teeth cleaned, I want you dressed as you were yesterday, and I want your beds made. And you have precisely 20 minutes to do all that.
But back in the 1940s, there was one last unsavoury job to perform.
Who used the chamber pot in the night? Hmm? Well, it looks as if it's been used. Who's the mystery person, then?
There's no fooling Mrs. Dobinson. Yes, someone's definitely used the chamber pot. But who?
I didn't do it, but... I don't mind emptying it.
Well, that's very kind of you, but whoever did use it should really say that they used it.
With no one owning up, it's left to a courageous Rachel to wash someone else's beastly business down the toilet.
It looks like there's going to be a chamber pot mystery.
I woke up in the night to go to the toilet and I thought I'm not using the chamber pot and there was all wee inside of it.
I definitely didn't do it. Everyone's suspicious about everyone else.
But back in the boys' room, there's no such mystery.
So, who were the users of the chamber pots?
Daniel.
And being the perfect gentleman, Daniel does the honours.
No,
so many cupboards.
In war-torn Britain, housing was in short supply, so people often had to bunk in together.
I've never slept in another bed with a boy, so...
Daniel kind of rolled over onto me a couple of times, and I think we both had a couple of nudges.
It was just really weird.
All in all, their first morning in wartime Britain has been a bit of a shock.
These straighteners, woman!
There's no running water. No showers. And barely any privacy.
Where's Nish?
There he is.
Oh, look, Nish came out of nowhere.
I got changed behind the door because I wanted privacy.
And it's just about to get a whole lot worse.
To keep the evacuees fit and healthy, during the war, the government recommended a daily dose of this stuff. Cod liver oil. It was the 1940s equivalent of vitamins. And this stuff is absolutely horrendous.
Into your mouth and you swallow. Open wide. Swallow.
Cod liver oil is literally made from fish guts.
Swallow. Open wide.
It might be good for you, but it tastes like a sardine's armpit.
Swallow. Open wide.
In my eye.
Swallow.
It doesn't taste
of any. I hate cod liver oil. That killed me.
And oh God, that's horrible. Disgusting.
To be honest, I actually threw up in my mouth and swallowed it again.
Mr. Dobson?
Mr. Henderson?
With the girls and boys, please come downstairs now, thank you.
It's their first morning, but there's no time for slacking. There's hundreds of jobs for the servants to do. Sorry, guys, that means you. There's breakfast to be made.
I can only cover my windows.
Shoes to be polished.
Mr. Henderson says we have to do this every day, just like in the army.
Floors to be swept. And the filthiest job of them all, clearing out the open fireplaces.
We have to clean the fire shelter when Her Ladyship and His Lordship come down.
We're going to put brand new coal in.
Yeah.
Mr. Henderson runs a tight ship, so it's vital that the boys learn to work well as a team. But the boys in the dining room are finding teamwork tough.
I'm not doing anything because these two are rude.
Unfortunately for Sam, Nish and Daniel, nothing gets past Mr. Henderson in this house.
Someone say shut up. Who said shut up? Did you say shut up, Sam?
Yes, because Nish was keep on moaning at me, saying that I'm not working at a team.
Sam wasn't doing any work because he was just walking around and telling us what to do.
Sam, you have plenty of chat, but I don't see any action. These boys are working really hard. Remember what I said?
I don't have a job to do. I want to work as a team, but they've took the jobs, the good jobs that I wanted.
He may have only arrived yesterday, but Sam has been in constant trouble. His screeching, horrified Miss Young.
What kind of behaviour is that?
I'm sorry, Miss Young.
His bad attitude angered Mr. Henderson.
Don't touch, you know, don't touch things without asking me first. Never mind how you look, it's how we think you look.
And his appalling table manners.
What are you doing? You're not using your fingers to edge cabbage, are you?
Have landed him in hot, soapy water.
Right, start washing.
Oh dear, it's only 8 a.m. and already Sam's having a bad day.
You're going to start pulling your weight or we're going to have problems, Sam.
Good morning again.
For over an hour, the evacuees have been working on an empty stomach. Apart from a teaspoon of cod liver oil, that is.
Thank you, God.
For the food we eat.
For the food we eat.
Also. Thank you for the British fleet.
Thank you for the British fleet. Thank you.
Finally, they get to eat. Whether you were eating upstairs with the Lord and Lady or downstairs with the servants, good manners were essential.
Elbows off the table, please.
Anybody conducting themselves in a sloppy fashion would have been considered extremely rude.
Remember how to hold your cups.
Your pinkies out.
You've got to remember, we're ladies and gentlemen, aren't we?
Easier said than done, Mr. Henderson.
I don't think that's the correct way to eat your breakfast.
Oh, sorry.
We do not make ourselves a sandwich at breakfast time.
But for fun-loving Scouser Jade, a knife and fork isn't always necessary. Especially when your favourite food is pizza.
Favourite food is pizza because it's got loads of taste to it, like the mushrooms and the sweet corn and the pepperonis and stuff.
So how will she cope not only being told what to eat, but how to eat it?
I think adults that think they know best and they're bossy and stuff, I think they annoy them because, like, oh, I've got to do something again. If they're not happy with me, well, I've done, I'll just say, well, I'll try my best. And that's the best I can do.
Sandwiches are for luncheon, certainly not for breakfast.
I feel like I'm dead posh because when I sit with your back up dead straight, I just want to be myself, I don't like being like that.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Dobson, be upstanding.
Houses like Pradoe Hall were run like a military operation, and Mr. Henderson wants one of the boys to take command.
Jack is my sergeant today, so he'll be in charge of the washing up.
There's no room for any prima donnas here. The other boys must listen to Jack, as he will be Mr. Henderson's eyes and ears for the day.
Mr. Henderson's known as the leader of these other boys, and if anything goes wrong, he's going to come to me.
Jack, how are we going?
We've only got this to do, sir.
With Jack as his deputy, he's chosen a boy who's not scared of a challenge.
My name's Jack Smith. They call me Have a Go Jack. I'll try anything. I'll do anything. Anything extreme, anything weird. Paragliding, scuba diving, swimming with dolphins.
Look.
I'm Have a Go Jack. I don't mind having a go at anything.
While Sergeant Jack is enjoying his new role, Mrs. Dobinson isn't happy. The bedrooms are a mess, and she still hasn't forgotten about that chamber pot.
Honesty is the most important thing, and I'm hoping that somebody will own up. It's perfectly natural to have to use the chamber pot. There's nothing wrong with using it. But what I did want to do this morning was to find out who'd used it, simply because we have to have a routine in this house. And to me, it seemed obvious that the person who'd used it on the first night should empty it. There's no one going to admit to it.
So, who is the culprit? Cool as a cucumber Mary's looking sheepish. Has Scouser Jade got something to hide? Olivia's playing it cool. Annabella's keeping stum. Sharon's looking shifty. Or is that a look of guilt on Rachel's face?
Well, I would just like to say that because we're living as we are, the first golden rule is one of honesty. Everyone must be honest. And if we don't get an admission during the course of the day, well, then I'm afraid everybody will suffer slightly. Thank you.
With Mrs. Dobinson gone, the accusations start flying.
Yeah, it could have been you two. It could have been you two. It could have been someone else. But you know who it is.
You were stuck in bed. I was stuck in bed. You were moving around like crazy.
If I said it was me, I would be lying. So I'm going to tell the truth and say, no, it wasn't me.
This is one mystery that just might drive them all potty.
Pradoe Hall and its grounds may well be home to a lord and lady, but not all of its inhabitants are quite so sophisticated. Come on, kids! It's a manor house!
Pradoe Hall sits on 800 acres of land. That's enough room for over 700 football pitches. And it's up to gamekeeper Mr. Goodall to keep the estate ship-shape.
Can you shut the gate, please? Last person through always shuts the gate.
Straight line.
The boys are about to learn another one of their daily duties, milking goats.
Before we go any further, just keep it quiet, all right? Because there's goats in the shed, okay?
The fresh that's moving.
And they're not used to you, okay? Come on, let's go.
Oh, yeah.
You see the collar on the neck, all right? Now you've got to try and catch her, okay? Come on, come on. What's the matter with you?
The thing about this goat is, she doesn't like to be milked.
No, I don't think we're going to do very well like this, are we, Jack?
Some roses.
Over in the walled garden, the girls are pursuing a more genteel activity. Flower arranging was considered an accomplishment for a young lady back in the 40s. And the good thing about flowers is, they don't run away.
Get that one there, look.
unlike goats.
All right, just hang on, Jack. Jack. That's it. Well done, Jack. OK.
That's the easy part done. Now all they have to do is extract enough milk for 12 evacuees. That's right. 12.
Your left hand on the far teat, then your right hand on the other teat. Ah, well, you find it. Come on. You can't find it. Well, Jack, you have a go then. See, we'll have a go and see who can get it to work.
Eventually, it's Yorkshireman Daniel who gets a result.
Are you sure you haven't done that before, Daniel?
Yeah. It felt like a rubber glove that had been filled with water with a hole in the bottom, and it felt all hairy. It were weird.
But it's hardly enough to make a cuppa, let alone 12. What are you laughing at? The boy's next job is a particularly smelly one, cleaning up the goat poo.
That is disgusting.
Everyone takes their turn mucking out. One boy doesn't want to get his hands dirty.
I'm not doing poo.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
I'm not.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
I'm doing nothing.
Well, Sam,
can you please get started?
You're doing it.
Mr. Gnoll's
doing
it. Really,
well,
let's just
then.
Get started.
Yeah. I think Sam is being a little bit selfish at the moment because he's not taking part and he's not helping us do what we're supposed to do. And
we don't need Sam, though. Yeah, no, we don't.
Oh, dear. It's mutiny in the ranks as sensitive Sam walks out on Sergeant Jack. All over a pile of poo.
Sam, hang on a minute, young man. Oi.
Sometimes you have to do things that you don't particularly want to do.
We could swap over jobs. I said you want to do poo, but I was happy if we could swap, like, do half of the 15 minutes doing poo and then the other half, hey?
You sweep the poo, and, yeah, you did a good job and stuff. I could tell that they were doing it on purpose.
So, for the second time today, Mr. Henderson has had to leave his duties to speak to Sam.
What was the problem?
Jack was giving me the worst job on purpose to sweep up the poo.
I've got a tight ship to run. I can't keep running after you all of the time. We've got rules and regulations in the house. And this is wartime. If we get young men running away from people who are supposed to be supervising, it's very, very dangerous.
Mr. Henderson's patience is running out. Pradoe Hall might look grand. So far, our evacuees have only just caught a glimpse of the magnificence that the Lord and Lady live in upstairs. All of that is about to change. Let's just hope that they mind their P's and Q's. Ooh, custard creams. That'll be all, Henderson.
Girls and boys, I've got a huge surprise for you. It's very unusual. Her Ladyship wants to invite you for a very formal three-course luncheon today in the main dining room.
The evacuees arrived at Pradoe Hall just 24 hours ago, along with their poor table manners, which Mr. Henderson wants to put right before lunch.
It's my mission to get their dining area up to scratch, because a reflection on myself, Her Ladyship, and as a house, we're all going to sit in our chairs and we're going to take you through each course. And it will make them better people, because it will give them the edge in life. Where should the napkin never go? Hands up.
Like in your collar?
Exactly. Right.
Why?
Why?
Because it's rude.
It is rude. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to have our soup. This is how I'd like you to do it. In, up.
The rules are simple. No placing the whole of the soup spoon into your mouth.
No. You're shoveling it in. You're a lady. Give me, like a lady.
Come on, Jade. You can do it.
Sit. And you put it back again. Right. Remember, elbows off the table.
No holding your fork like a spade or your knife like a pen.
Can you all hold your knife and fork like that now, please?
And the biggest crime against dining etiquette?
A knife is not for putting into the mouth.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Oh, everything has to be perfect. Very, very perfect.
Why?
Yeah.
Because you don't compromise your standards. You have pride in yourself.
I think it's better in the 1940s, the way you have to do it, but the only thing I don't like about it is the way you have to do it perfect.
So, with lunch fast approaching, Mr. Henderson gets the evacuees smartened up for their first big test.
but one of them won't be going anywhere.
This morning, when Sam was Mr. Goodall, he ran away. And to me, that was disrespectful. And there was no way that he was going to attend a formal luncheon with the lady.
Good afternoon, Your Ladyship. Your guests are now waiting for you for luncheon.
Lady Alstead prides herself on being one of the finest hostesses in the county. She's used to entertaining royalty, but what will she make of her new guests?
Yeah, I'm going to be on my best behaviour to see the lady because I don't know what she'll be like, if she'll be strict or nice.
I'm a bit worried about my table manners because Mr. Henderson pulled me up about it this morning and said to be careful, so I'll ask to be careful because he said he'd be watching me.
Girls and boys, Your Ladyship.
Good afternoon, girls and boys.
Good afternoon, Your Ladyship.
Since the evacuees arrived, they've been living off basic rations. But today, they'll get a three-course meal, which would have been considered quite a luxury. First up is the vegetable soup.
Beautiful homemade soup, ma'am.
Looks delicious.
Mr. Henderson will be keeping a close eye on the evacuees' table manners.
Seems to be very strict, that butler. It seems so crazy to make a mistake.
You milked the goats?
Yes,
now, was that very difficult?
It was quite difficult at first.
Who was the most successful?
Daniel.
Oh, Daniel, because it's quite a knack, isn't it, milking?
It's very quiet in there. Just a few little titters of polite conversation.
But while the lady is politely chatting, bad eating habits have broken out at the other end of the table. Jade and Annabella have forgotten where they are, but their bread-dunking antics haven't escaped the eagle eye of Mr. Henderson. Oh dear, Jade, and this is just the first course. Next up is a real treat.
Here comes the butler. There you go.
So we've got a lot of sheep out there.
Pigeon pie, man.
Pigeon pie made out of real pigeons was a popular dish in the 1940s, but it's not everyone's cup of tea.
Nothing to do. I don't think you'll ever get bored. There's so much to do.
Fussy eater Mary is picky about her meat. Fortunately, there's plenty of vegetables to eat. But not with the knife. A closer look shows that it's not just Mary's manners that have started to slip, as our diners have found novel ways of using their forks. There's Jade's shovel. Olivia's shall I, shan't I? Mary's who needs a fork anyway? And back to Olivia, who finally opts for the one-handed approach.
My lady, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our lunch for today. Her ladyship will retire for the afternoon.
Thank you, children. Very nice to meet you. I hope you've enjoyed your lunch. I look forward to seeing you again, and I hope you're very happy. Goodbye.
Pigeon pie, that put me off a bit, like pigeon, but I still ate it. It was nice, like.
I really didn't want to eat the pigeon pie because usually you see pigeons because... And usually you see pigeons, they're just like flying around like in the street and stuff and like looking through your rubbish and stuff like that. And it's not really appetizing.
The pigeon pie didn't go down well. Something else has left a bad taste in Henderson's mouth.
But the actual dining etiquette was atrocious. It was like pigs at the trough. Good afternoon, girls and boys.
Good afternoon, Mr. Henderson.
How did you find lunch today?
Yeah, it was very good.
More than I thought, actually. I was very disappointed with the way you behaved in lunch. I'm just going to undertake on to guide you through about dining etiquette. So in future, when you dine with her ladyship, you're going to have the confidence and the edge to be able to dine with them.
Later on that afternoon, with no one owning up to using the chamber pot, Mrs. Dobinson calls the girls into the game hanging room.
Come along in here, please, girls.
She won't let this mystery defeat her. Because if there's one thing Mrs. Dobinson can't abide, it's dishonesty.
So I'm going to ask you one last time who used the chamber pot. Otherwise, you're all going to have to undergo a punishment.
Is all about to be revealed in the final chapter of the potty saga? apparently not.
So, girls, I'm afraid it means cleaning some silver.
And to make matters worse, they're to do it here, in the game hanging room. And man, do these pheasants pong.
I'm just annoyed that nobody's owned up, really.
Yeah.
And us having to do the polishing when some of us shouldn't really be doing it.
Do you want me to say who I thought it was?
No. I thought it was... I really don't want to be mean. I thought it was you two.
What?
Honestly, because you stayed up all night. I was like,
yeah.
I think. Alright, let's shut up about it now. No one's gonna find out. No one's gonna admit it, are they? No one's wasting our death on it, so shut up.
The girls have learned that it only takes one person to let the side down. It's an important lesson in wartime, and one the boys are about to consider.
The reason I brought you here today, away from the ladies, because now we need a man-to-man talk. You know, there's one part of the team that is not here with us. Who can tell me who that is? Jan?
Sam.
Do you think I should go back to Sam now and say, look, the rest of the gentlemen want to bring you back into the group and to give you a chance?
Yes, Sam.
I'll be back in a second. Just remain here, gentlemen.
Mr. Henderson hopes that by appealing to Sam's better nature, he'll fall into line and make more of an effort.
Now, Sam, if you have problems or challenges, I will help you. Is that a deal?
Yeah.
But in order for that deal to succeed, I need your commitment, because you have to go by my rules in order for this to work. What do you say to that?
I'll say okay.
Boys, I've spoken to Sam. He agrees that he has made a mistake, but as a gentleman, he wants to come back into the team. Agreed?
Yep.
I want you to shake the hand with each boy, each gentleman, look them in the eye, and say thank you. Off you go.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Henderson is a fair man because he was talking to me like an adult, not just like I'm a child.
Well done, boys. Let's go and play some cricket. Come on.
War is one of those things that brings people apart but also brings other people closer together.
I hope that all the problems with Sam are over now and it's going to be a fresh start.
The situation with Sam is now resolved and everyone's getting on a lot better now.
I'm just glad that I know that I have these brilliant people who are going to stick by me.
Well said, Nish. Let's just hope it stays that way.